Good morning. Thank you. It's so good to be with you. And thank you for coming back home to this incredible building. Welcome to the 2022 Alumni Reunion. And for people who are watching online who are not alumni, welcome to you as well. This weekend, we are celebrating the 50th reunions of the graduating classes of 1970, 1971, and 1972. After being physically apart for 2 years, it's great to be gathered together today and see everyone in person. And I've learned so much about the tunnels between Reed Hall and Hampton House, and the people who looked out over the tunnels to see who was coming and going, and the Pinkerton guards, and it's been very interesting. And yesterday I got to see some of your applications for coming to Johns Hopkins, and some of the wording was really horrifying, I have to say, but really so inspiring to read some of your essays for getting in and to talk to so many of you yesterday about your careers and all the different things that you've done. Really, really, truly inspiring. Thank you for coming home. As we begin, we want to acknowledge the land upon which our school sits. The Johns Hopkins School of Nursing respectfully acknowledges and gives thanks to the Piscataway tribe, the indigenous people who are traditional owners of the lands of the Chesapeake Bay region. We also acknowledge all indigenous peoples who are the traditional owners of the lands and waters of the United States of America. So we really look forward to all the events scheduled this weekend and hope that it's a time to celebrate you as our alumni, to remember the history of our school, and to honor the legacy of many distinguished nurses. For many of you, it's probably the first time you're seeing our newly renovated building, and you can see it's breathtaking. I'm just happy walking around in it. I just walk around, say hi to people. Later today, there'll be a time to tour the building, and I hope you'll recognize how the classrooms, the courtyard, and all the other spaces speak to both our traditions and history, as well as to the future. This is the space where the next generation of nursing leaders will come to learn, innovate, and become Hopkins nurses. Whether you graduated 50 years ago, or like Nancy and I, 29 years ago, or are still on your way to that marker, like me, what I think connects all of us is the excellence that comes with being a Hopkins nurse. And as Trish Davidson, our beloved recent dean, accurately phrased it, excellence without elitism. Across the generations, the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing has prepared nurses at the highest level to think critically, to break through stereotypes, to prioritize people, and to be proud to be a nurse. Those ideals have guided our teaching, research, and service missions throughout the years and continue to be the values that lead us into the future. So as we gather today, it's important to remember that you are part of that legacy. Our alumni are the foundation upon which our school stands, and it's an honor to commemorate your part in our history and continued success. And on a personal note, I want to say that I know some people have expressed that having been at the Hopkins training program is different than the university, but we're all in this together. We need all of us at this time in nursing. We so appreciate your role in our history. So I'm just thrilled to be here with you and celebrating this special reunion weekend. Oh, and I didn't want not just Hopkins Hospital, but church also. And I trained at church as part of my undergraduate degree here. So I just were church and Hopkins. It's now my pleasure to officially begin our Isabel Hampton Robb Lecture Series. We're live streaming this presentation, so welcome to everyone who's joining us virtually as well. As many of you know, in 1889, Isabel Hampton Robb became first superintendent of nurses at the Johns Hopkins Hospital and principal of its nursing school. Isabel Hampton Robb was an exceptional scholar and visionary. She reformed education, was intrigued by national and international nursing developments, and was known for her practical and thought-provoking ideas. And there's a theme of that in Dr. Glass's work as well. Isabel Hampton Robb was dedicated to the sciences and was pivotal in paving the way for a new view of nursing, that nurses are not only kind, but smart and educated. It was under her leadership that our school became known for professionalism of nursing education and the profession. Robb also contributed to nursing ethics as she authored the first nursing ethics textbook in the United States. Robb was a firm and confident leader who went on to become one of the founders of the American Nurses Association. It's because of her legacy that we established the Isabel Hampton Robb Dean's Lecture in 2018. It honors her memory and highlights the exceptional leaders who have followed her. And with that backdrop, it's my great pleasure to introduce our 2022 Isabel Hampton Robb Scholar, Dr. Nancy Glass. But you'll be clapping a lot harder when you hear a little bit more about her. Dr. Glass is an accomplished nurse, advocate, and teacher. As a renowned researcher, Dr. Glass has worked relentlessly to prevent domestic violence and improve the safety and well-being of women and children locally and around the world. With expertise in both nursing and public health, Dr. Glass has implemented and evaluated innovative programs that challenge social norms that sustain violence, prevent violence against women. She is well known for her programs Pigs for Peace and Rabbits for Resilience, which are Congolese livestock microfinance initiatives to help women and children gain economic stability. She is also a developer of the well-known My Plan app, a tool that helps survivors of intimate partner violence understand their level of danger and make personalized plans for safety. And they're both obviously really important, and you'll hear a lot about them, but in the beginnings of the intimate partner violence movement, there was a lot of blame. Women often felt blamed, like, why didn't you leave him? And Dr. Glass's work is really groundbreaking in changing that. In all of her work, Dr. Glass is committed to collaborating with and mentoring colleagues and students globally. And she takes that role seriously. She's a fierce protector of her students, knowing how to guide them to their best science while also learning from them. In 2015, Dr. Glass was named the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing's Independence Foundation Chair in Nursing Education. She is Associate Director of the Johns Hopkins Center for Global Health, and she has a joint appointment in the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Besides who she is professionally, Nancy regularly beats me running. Always ready with a piece of advice or a story about her nieces and nephews. And there's not a person who loves dogs more. Dr. Glass is a colleague, friend, a fellow alumna to us all, and we are proud that she is part of our school.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you very much. Or Dean Zanton. I think that's the best. It's fun to say that, especially when we grew up together here. It's so exciting to be in Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. It's been a while. I bet everybody's happy to be back. I'm especially honored to have the opportunity to do the Robb Lecture. It's a real honor to be here, to be with the alumni, I hope to talk about something that's of interest and maybe a little challenging and leads to questions and conversations. I think that's what we're all here for. And so I said I wouldn't walk away, but here I am walking away. As I was thinking about this lecture, I really was thinking about some of the challenges that we're all experiencing. Just make sure I've got to hit the right buttons. Just some of the challenges we're all seeing in the world today. And I do admit that I look at it from a lens of women's health in everything I look at. And so these are some of the images that I thought about that have really impacted me over the last couple years. An image of, familiar to all of us, nurses gowning up, getting ready to go in and care for patients, especially in this really challenging time globally. I work in Congo. Ebola has been a significant issue. We think about Zika. We think about other pandemics, but certainly COVID-19 has been with us so strongly, and nurses' incredible role. I also think of what's happening in our country around what I believe is a woman's right, and it's a human right, to be able to make decisions about her body, and how close we are, I think, to losing that choice, as we watch other countries come on board with legislation that support a woman's right to choose. Then we see in Ukraine, which we didn't expect to see, is young families fleeing the situation, families that look like us, where we often see families that don't look like us, and so how we've responded differently has been an interesting lesson for all of us. And then I've been working most recently with Afghanistan and the midwives, Afghanistan Midwife Association, which is an amazing group of leaders, and these are young women in Afghanistan and their mothers demanding the right to education, really putting their lives on the line right now and demanding for opportunity to go to school. So these are some of the issues that we are all facing in the world. So I want to certainly talk about women and health and disease, but I think that before I launch into that talk, I want to step back and examine some of the meanings of the terms we use now. And they are evolving. And our definitions, I would dare to say, differ. And this is especially important in the areas of sex and gender, because both, and especially the term gender, is in a state of flux. And what you and I may have talked about in sex and gender is very different from what our students are talking about in sex and gender now. And so we're all coming along in that education. And we can debate these terms and these definitions, and I will describe that there are some points of disagreement, and we need to work. But however, as I move through this talk, I want to work from a common definition. Again, people may not agree with the definitions I'm using, but I want to talk about these concepts in the context of equity and health equity. And so let's just begin with the term sex. You and I, when we would go to the healthcare provider's office, we were asked, what is our sex? And we would say male and female. We're seeing a change in that, where that now we're that term would be more... more often you'll see, what is your gender, male and female. So what I'm defining as sex, or it's defined here in this very tiny writing that most of you, I can't see. Hold on one second. So I'm going to look at my notes, because I don't want to mess up the terms that I'm trying to define here. These are biological attributes, or of humans and other animals, including chromosomes, gene expression, hormones, and reproductive and genital anatomy. As such, sex refers to the various biological attributes and defines someone as male, female, or intersex. And I'm going to return to this later. Now, by contrast, how I'm using gender is it is a culturally defined roles, responsibilities, and attributes, as well as entitlements associated with being male and female in a given setting. Thus, gender is what social scientists have called socially constructed, and which basically means it's a product of society, not biology. So interestingly for me, the term gender was originally and has been popularized by feminists in the 70s, especially in my area of work related to gender-based violence, to really acknowledge the power differential in society, in relationships, in institutions. And basically as a counterpoint, the goal was the use of gender as a counterpoint to the perception that male and females our differences are just natural, and therefore these differences can't be changed. We can't change what's happening in institutions, what's happening with unequal pay. It just can't be changed. There's just natural differences. So that's where we've started to use gender to challenge and think of gender as defining gender as a social construct. So I'm going to go a little further. and just think about the competing meanings of gender. And I started to talk about this. Gender is a substitute for sex, but we're also looking at gender as an identity now. And this is very important. And over the past 20 years, I would say, gender has increasingly been used as what we've said, a substitute for the word sex. But also, a common understanding of gender is the context of identity. Gender identity is frequently defined as a person's internal psychological sense of being male or female, or a blend of both. One's identity, one's gender identity, can be the same or different from one's sex assigned at birth. And there are a multitude of terms that are continually evolved for identity. Non-binary, gender fluid, transgender, male, female. And these are constantly changing. And importantly, I think that we're constantly, as nurses and working with patients from with define themselves in a diverse identity, are also learning with our students. So it's highly fluid and it's an evolving concept, and including both people who feel they've been born into the wrong body and seek to align their bodies with their internal sense of self, to individuals who don't want to be bound by the social construct of male, feminine, and masculinity that commonly accompany being born male or female. While important this is to understand gender, understanding gender, and gender identity, this is not the definition I'm going to focus on in my talk. I'm really talking about the gender as a social construct, and really coming from a perspective of, I'm an early feminist, from the perspective of gender as a social system. So what do I mean by gender as a social system? So, for example, in many parts of the world, and I'm not talking about everybody's individual experiences may be very different. You may live in a very, you may feel like you have not had these experiences. Relationships may be very equal. Your institutional setting where you work, nurses, we have a lot of women at this school. It's a very different environment than other settings. So I'm not speaking about individual experiences. I'm speaking about a global population of women. And in many parts of the world, it's deeply hierarchical. And where males or the masculine is at the top, and feminine or female is not equal in the sense of roles were more typically focused on domestic labor, childcare, cooking, cleaning, and men are expected to be the economic providers. These roles and expectations as are norms that are set with us very early in life, from childhood in our homes where we see and we're taught roles within our own families, to when we the books we read, the toys we give our children, etc. And so these messages are really deeply held within us. Sometimes they're unconscious to the norms that we and you know, society's institutions tend to coalesce around the same gendered assumptions, with things like childcare responsibilities, leave policies, or the lack of leave policies, employment compensation, and the structure of work organized around a division of labor that is highly gendered. I think we can all think of times when the meeting has been scheduled at 6 o'clock or 5 o'clock, and you're the one who needs to prepare meals for the kids. And if you're not at that meeting, decisions you know are going to be made that won't have a voice, your voice there, or represent. So there's a lot of conflicts in how. The larger point here is that gender is conceptualized and is more than identity. It is an entire social system that structures many aspects of our lives. And in many parts of the world, it is a social system that is deeply unequal. As we saw from the beginning pictures, where we saw those young women in Afghanistan begging for the right to go to opportunity to go to education. If you ever listen to the Daily podcast, New York Times podcast, last week they did a piece about Afghanistan women and young women who had been in college, and they talked about their dreams and what they were studying, and they went through this period of you know, not being able to, their university's closed, they can't go to school, very depressed, very upset. And then they moved to this period where they said, I went to a bookstore, I bought books. Every day, I'm going to teach myself something different. Mm-hmm. They're learning French. They're learning how, they're painting. So they still are focused on their dreams. And their dreams are so, you know, I'm going to be a computer scientist. I'm going to be the great sculptor. I mean, they hear those dreams and just know what they're facing is very powerful in supporting them, needing to support them. I think we also need to talk about intersectionality. And some people have made this a bad word. I don't think it is a bad word. It is just acknowledging that these axes intersect. Gender does not act alone in the world. It acts with power, privilege, and identity. And I think this is a really great example is race isn't a risk factor in maternal health. Racism is. We often see in the literature race as a risk factor. That's really not what is going on. It is racism. And we know this in recent years. A lot more attention has been given to how these various factors interact. And importantly, women are not a homogeneous group, and neither are men. And for a long time, people just compared groups of individuals along two couple dimensions. We looked at health outcomes by women versus men, African American versus white, people who lived in rural areas, people who lived in urban areas. But focusing on health outcomes averaged across an entire demographic group really hides the important distinctions within groups. So while women on average have less power than men, this is not true for all women and for all men. Importantly, other forms of advantage and disadvantage interact with gender to affect the health status of both men and women. So this is the concept of intersectionality. Some people want to call it critical race theory. But really what we're talking about are things like class, race, disability, how they interact in a complex way to determine the individual's position in a social hierarchy. Where one stands in that hierarchy has a profound impact and implication on their health. This is what we mean by a social position. And how does intersectionality play out in health? Well, an excellent example is the phenomenon in our country of severe maternal morbidity and mortality among African American women in the U.S. According to the CDC, black women in the U.S. die at 3 to 4 times the rate of white mothers. One of the widest of all racial disparities in our country and in women's health. Put another way, a black woman is 22% more likely to die from heart disease than a white woman, 71% more likely to die from cervical cancer, but 243% more likely to die from pregnancy or childbirth-related causes. So that makes us question, certainly, what is going on. So, and it's not just socioeconomic status that account for these differences. We used to say, oh, it's poor, non-poor. There's a lot of other factors, and that's what intersectionality gives us. So we also talk about health equity. We've moved from a focus on, and we've talked about health disparities for many years. There's a difference. These health disparities and health equity are often used interchangeably. They're not interchangeable. You know, we all recognize there's a big difference in health outcomes for men and women. We know that globally, life expectancy gap between men and women is 4.6 years. Women outliving men in all countries, and a gap of almost over 10 years in some countries. However, women also experience a higher burden of morbidity, experiences with health conditions, and typically report worse health than men, even though they live longer. So we know that some of these differences certainly are clearly driven largely by biological differences. For example, prostate cancer. Women don't have prostate cancer. Others are driven by a combination of both social and biological differences between men, women, and gender diverse individuals. So if we think about some of the differences, I mentioned reproductive anatomy, prostate cancer, but females have a more aggressive immune response. So we see more autoimmune disorders like lupus. Sexual differences in metabolisms of toxins, with women potentially facing greater risk from fat-soluble chemicals because of our higher proportion of fat tissue and our slower metabolism. So these are just examples of differences. When I'm talking about health inequity, I'm talking about unjust and unavoidable differences rising from inequality and structured disadvantage. And so that's a very different language. And you know, a health disparity, like I said, we've talked a lot about differences in COVID, and I'll talk a little bit more about COVID because that's the only thing we tend to talk about these days. But we do talk about disparities do refer to a higher burden of illness, injury, or disability, or mortality experienced by one group relative to another. And the outbreak of and coronavirus offers a good example of disparity. Black and Hispanic patients or Latino patients were more likely to contract illness and experience higher rates of hospitalization than their white peers. That disease burden was higher for Black and Hispanic patients than it was for white patients, resulting in a disparity. However, it also has the impact of a health inequity. The reasons why many African Americans and Latina men and women contracted the COVID is their jobs that they work. They were more likely to work in the public sector, in service industry, in healthcare, in nursing homes, and were not given, as we know early on, many of the protections needed. And so this is what we talk about. These are avoidable and unjust differences arriving from structural disadvantage. So what we're working towards, hopefully, is everyone having a fair and just opportunity to be as healthy as possible. So now I'm just going to get on how does gender affect health? And this is something I spent a lot of time thinking about. And so I'm going to talk about it on three different components: gender inequity. So what I mean here is the unequal access to power, resources, opportunities, and status by virtue of one's sex or gender identity. So thinking about pay gaps between men and women, and this is a global figure, but not very different from the U.S. Without decisive action, it will take another 68 years to achieve equal pay. And people say that has changed now post-COVID. This was before COVID, where now we see a mass exit of the workforce by women because of their other multiple responsibilities. And I can, as I look at my colleagues here that have young children, I don't know how in the world they did it. I really don't. I have no idea. I don't know how I did it. And I got nothing. I don't even have a dog anymore. So, I just am amazed. Women make up only about a quarter of the parliamentarians worldwide. And when you looked at the decision-making bodies around COVID and about building back around global health, very few women are on these boards. And that is going to impact how we recover. And we continue to do almost three times the unpaid care and domestic work that men do. And in 39 countries, daughters still do not have equal access to inheritance as their brothers. And that, we know, impacts wealth long term. And let's just take a quick look at the U.S. We are not better. Only 24% of Congress members are women. Women make almost 20% less money than men. And 1 in 6 women report being stalked to the point of fearing harm to themselves or someone they love. This is a picture that I will never forget. And the anger that flowed over me at that moment is still, when I see it, flows over me. And I thought Patty Murray said an amazing thing. She said, cynically, a rare look at the GOP Women's Health Caucus. So this is real. This was a picture of a conversation about maternal and child health in this country. This is real. And, you know, certainly there was blowback, but there was not one person in this room who thought, this is an issue. That's what amazed me. That is what amazed me. So gender norms. So these are the often, and this is what I've been working on a lot related to gender-based violence and victim blaming, as Sarah talked about. These are the unspoken norms or rules that govern the attributes and the behaviors that are valued and considered acceptable for males and females within a given culture or a social structure. And we see these all the time, the 15 manliest cars on the road. And men are more likely to be involved in road traffic crashes than women. 73% of all road traffic deaths occur among young males under the age of 25 years. Young males almost 3 times more likely than female to be killed in a road crash. It goes on and on, because these are the messages from a very young age we give young men, that risk-taking is brave, risk-taking is masculine, you're cool. And so these are the words that we constant, these are the messages. And then the opposite, the toxic femininities, labiaplasty. Yeah. Yeah, and you know, I just spent a couple weeks in Ethiopia. We're working with UNICEF in Ethiopia around reducing child marriage and female genital cutting. And here we look at what's happening globally around something like labiaplasty. This is vaginal surgery where professionals, physicians, reduce a woman's inner labia, often to keep them from protruding beyond the outer labia. And in 2017, a global survey, it was the fastest growing cosmetic procedure in the world. Now why? Why? The now common practice of Brazilian waxing is contributing to this trend. Because now you can see, right? Making visible physical structures that were previously covered up. Also implicated in this upsurge is pornography, which is frequently watched by both sexes from an early age, and what is considered feminine and beautiful. And at the irony of all this is, at the same time that I'm out talking about FGM and a harmful practice, we're seeing that in the UK, the NHS pays for labial surgery. Okay, all right. So we need to have a reflection on this. And it's being paid for, this is practice in the US and Europe. And so the other is the example of practice that undermine health in the name of beauty. The bleaching of skin to become more, the skin lightening creams marketed to women. I see this a lot in Congo. These creams include talc, mercury, and other harmful substances. And the World Health Organization study found that 40% of Chinese women regularly use skin lightening creams. And the number is even higher in India, and 77% in Nigeria. Because that is what is perceived as beauty, even though we know it impacts our health. So the behaviors are certainly linked to norms. Also, we're starting to see this erosion of restrictive norms can sometimes erode some of what was considered protective, right? So it seems that women are trying to catch up with men in binge drinking, and it's really, really scary. was a quote that I saw that I thought was very interesting. And then I thought of myself and how, you know, mother's little helpers, you know, the advertising now that we see that around women and health and wine, these, and just the mind-blowing, the first one, believe all, Belvedere always goes down smoothly. That's rape. That's the subtle cue of sexual assault there, and how that's, yeah. And but then the one, the imagery, and so alcohol advertising directed towards women, for example, promotes drinking as a means to manage their emotions. Hey, don't we say, I could use a drink. Okay, or I could use a glass of wine. Well, some of us say that. I'm not saying everybody says that. The industry strategy for reaching women in high-income countries often highlight our body image, weight control, you know, skinny wine. I don't know if y'all have seen that in your stores. But, or have hiring, and this is very similar to what we saw with cigarettes, right? Glamorizing it is very masculine or very feminine. We're seeing this certainly with alcohol. And these are the norms that constantly played upon. And then our gender relations. And this term really, I think, is very important in my work. It refers to the distribution of power and influence and status between and among women and men. And we see this in institutions. We see this as our own relationships. And most gendered systems afford men and things coded as masculine or male with greater power and status than women or things coded as female. And certainly in my work, we see this as a significant contribution to violence against women and girls. And I just want to take just one quick minute.
ladka ya ladki, in dono mein se doctor kaun hai?
हवाई जहाज कौन चला सकता
है? The boy. लड़का. जो ज्यादा काम कर रहे हैं हवाई जहाज भी कंट्रोल कर सकते हैं
क्योंकि लड़की चला नहीं पाएगी इसलिए लड़की.
पढ़ाई कौन अच्छी करता है?
लड़का.
लड़का.
बॉय. मैथ्स में ये अच्छा है.
और लड़की क्या सोचेगी कि मुझे क्या बनना है?
डांसर, टीचर.
क्रिकेट कौन खेलता है?
लड़का.
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 बॉय. इन दोनों में से पैसे किसके पास?
नहीं, लड़के के पास.
इनके पास.
इसके पास.
बॉय.
बॉय काम करते हैं
क्योंकि ये तो घर का काम संभालेगी ना.
Tell me Sesame Street isn't amazing. And so I've said all this to build up to the crisis is a magnifier for gender and health inequity. And that's what we're seeing now globally. It has magnified the inadequate investments in our public health systems. We can all relate to how did we get to this point? And we know as nurses of the lack of investment in institutions, the public health system, the small numbers of nurses as public health nurses, you know, the lack of resources put into our public health departments has had a significant impact on how we've responded. And that there's no real safety net for vulnerable populations, and the gross inequities in what we value as a global community, not valuing teachers, nurses, healthcare. It shows, this is the scaffold that keeps our institutions together, and it was very clear this was not a valued resource. And so the impact is significant. And so I think about COVID-19 and how we have these global development goals and really focusing on social determinants of health. And one of the goals, number 5, is to achieve gender equality and empower all girls. And I think we can all agree there's been massive improvements. I think we can all agree. But we're in a place where we might take some steps backwards, I fear. And we are growing in leadership. We are seeing more leaders, women leaders globally, and in very significant positions. But fewer girls, fewer girls are forced into early marriage. There's new policies, global laws about marriage before the age of 18, although in our own country, not so true. Check out some of your state laws. Shocking. Again, I travel around the world doing programs around, and sometimes I look at myself, I'm like, I should go to Virginia. You know, I live there. We got some problems there. More women are in leadership roles, so we really have seen improvement. But the lockdowns have had multiple implications. And in my area of work, lockdowns have increased the risk of violence against women and girls. Cases of domestic violence have increased by 30% in some countries. And this comes from reports to advocacy programs, to hotlines, to police. And then we also are seeing women are bearing additional household burdens. And so women are saying they're spending about 3 times as many hours in unpaid domestic and care work as men. Men see it differently. If you ask men, they think they're there. So there's not the same perspective on this. But we are hearing stories about women leaving the workforce because of educating their children, home care, the things that they just felt like they could not do all of it, the work and all the other responsibilities. And again, we still don't have enough leadership. And women account for 70% of health and social workers, and we know who's taken the largest burden of the diseases in our health systems. In my area of work, you know, 1 in 3 women report lifetime physical or sexual abuse by an intimate partner. And that really is 243 million women and girls aged 15 to 49 experienced sexual physical violence in the last year by an intimate partner. And that was before the pandemic. Since the pandemic, what our research is showing us is the lack of financial stress, losing jobs, spending off savings, lack of security creates conflict in the home. And these are homes that oftentimes already have conflict, and the conflict escalates and violence can occur. Cramped living conditions, around the world, people are sharing small spaces and can't go out, can't move. Isolation with abuser, they can't take a respite and leave the home, escape to their mother's or their friend's house. Movement restrictions, and then those deserted public spaces, not being able to go to the services that had once been helpful and open. This is an image that was drawn by our young people that we work with in Nairobi, and we sort of, as they drew this, we took pictures of it. I mean, you know, as they talked about the impact, the gendered effect of COVID-19 among adolescents and youth in Nairobi, these are the images that came forth. And, you know, it really talks about the loss of income, the social confinement, the broken communication, and the violence. I thought this was a great representation of the struggles that people are having and also around family planning and safety. So, you know, the systems that we've created to help and respond to disease and respond to violence they're gender biased in many situations. Providers are biased in their diagnosis and care. We know that when we talk about health disease. I'm not an expert in, cardiovascular disease, but women are, you know, we're often told, well, you know, an autoimmune disease, psychological, you're depressed, you're stressed, and, you know, we're not listened to in a way we should be about our own bodies. Career advancement, we all struggle. In the UK, for example, female doctors earn 40% less than their male counterparts. Lancet Nature and Science issued a mea culpa about their lack of female authors and reviewers in the last 2 years. They just realized it. And for years, Tokyo Medical University manipulated the women's scores. I don't know if y'all heard about this, their test scores, to keep the number of women down in the medical schools because they were scoring better than the male candidates and they didn't want as many women. In the US, 30% of women who are in clinical researchers report experiencing sexual assault versus 4% of men. So these are some of the challenges in the healthcare system for patients, but also providers and for women to move within the institution. So I just am closing on sort of as my thinking around some of the systems, how to, we're going to build back better. That's what I keep saying. Mm-hmm. And we're going to, a gendered responsive health system that could address COVID-19, but also address other inequities in the health outcomes. So we really need to think of it as an ecological framework. We use this framework a lot in nursing and a lot in violence against women. We have to look at the individual factors for both men and women. Certainly, as COVID was going on, we saw such an impact on maternal care. How were women getting access to prenatal, postpartum care, safe pregnancies? It was a real struggle. All these systems were closing. And women didn't feel safe. I talked to many women, for example, in Afghanistan, and talking with the midwives there, women aren't going to the health systems because they don't feel safe going there, security issues. And also, they know the health systems don't have medications anymore. So they're giving birth in homes, which we all know increase the risk, without skilled attendants. So addressing health risk for men as well, certainly, and thinking about what are their greatest health risks, but just thinking about interpersonal, protecting women, certainly from intimate partner violence, implement gender-sensitive measures to support women. If women are 70% of the health care providers, we need more protections. We need child care policies. We need leave policies. We have different responsibilities. We need different policies to support us. And then the redistribution of unpaid work. Protect and compensate women fairly, please. And ensure that 50% of the leadership in these pandemic response have women's voices. That we don't, it's not a zero-sum game. We're not just putting women to replace men. We think women have valuable contributions to building back, and their viewpoint is essential. I'm going to leave you with just one last thing that really bugs me. And this is an academic medicine. And I think many people can relate to this and what's happening. And I'd like to say that things have gotten better, but actually things have gotten worse. We went from women at the tenure track about 16% to now 12% in academic medicine. And this is after multiple efforts, right? Something's happening between the non-tenure track, what it takes to get on a tenure track, who gets the opportunity to go on a tenure track. We're seeing a lot of women being given adjunct or non-tenure track positions. Especially, there's also the fear from women that they won't be able to hold on because they want to have children, they want to have some work-life balance. So women are making decisions to get off the track because of the way the structure is. We really, really need to think that. And my last point, because I know I've gone long, is that we're beyond nature and nurture here. And I think as we've started to think about how racism gets under the skin, and I'm deeply the embodiment of years of racism and trauma, how that impacts your health, we know that's real. Does years of gender-based violence, gender discrimination, sexism also get under the skin? And how does that intersectionality impact women's health over the long term? Thank you very much.
Time for a few questions if anyone wants to ask a question of Dr. Glass. Okay, well, you're overwhelmed with her brilliance, and stay here. Thank you so much. It's been fantastic hearing of your work and your impact, and to show our appreciation, we have a small token under here.
It's $1 million.
Our 2022 Isabel Hampton Robb
this
Scholar.
This is great.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Tara.
And we'll have a short break before the reunion class sessions at 11:15. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.